Hey everyone, my name is Matt. Welcome to my shop. So this past weekend was Thanksgiving, and my whole family comes to town for that. And we had a charcuterie spread thing going on. And my sister was like, you know, I really want a bigger serving tray slash charcuterie board for my house. And I looked at her and I said, I already made you those before. And she's like, they're not big enough. So the one that I had was obviously a lot bigger than what she has. A video that I made 3 years ago actually made the serving tray slash charcuterie board that she has at her house. It's one of those bigger live edge things that I made 3 years ago. Now, the last couple of years, I've been making these little charcuterie tray board things, and I have a few of these left still, but this is not big enough for what she wants. She wants something a lot bigger than this, and she wants something a little more substantial, so she wants a little more thickness, similar to what she has with that smaller one that I made a few years ago. So if you want to check out that video that I made 3 years ago while making that one tray, the smaller one, a bunch of them actually, I will leave you a link to that as well as a link to the video where I made, you know, these typical things. So I went looking through my small kind of slab section of my lumber storage area, and I found this guy. It is kind of split in half. So this is a slab from the very first urban tree that I salvaged. This was part of the canopy area. This tree was removed because it had extensive carpenter ant damage. And as you can see from this guy, you can see all of the carpenter ant tunnels going through here. So that caused this limb to kind of split apart. That's actually what happened to the entire tree, is it was splitting apart. And the homeowners didn't want to fall over one day and possibly hit their house. So it was removed. I chainsaw milled the whole thing, including all these smaller chunks that I grabbed as well. And this is gonna work out really nicely for this serving tray. So two things before we get started. First off, I'm really excited about this because this is going to be a small and relatively quick project. I typically do more larger in-depth projects, which take a lot more time. Something like this is fun just to get out here and knock out and be done with it. The other thing is that I'm gonna see my sister in 2 weeks. So I'm gonna hopefully have this ready for her when I see her again. So I got a pretty short amount of time and I have a pretty quick project, so I'm extra excited on this one. So if I flip this thing over, you can see I already started to flatten this once upon a time with the router sled. Looks like I probably got through flattening this whole section, kind of ran out of connecting meat and these things came apart. And what's nice about that now is that since they're two pieces, now they fit through my milling machines, which is gonna make this really easy. The other thing is, this is gonna allow me to connect these things back together and fill in all these voids with some epoxy. So, you know, I enjoy that too. So this should be a fun little project. So let's get started. I'm gonna go through and just surface these things down. I'm gonna run them over the jointer, bring them into flat, and then bring them through the planer for a few passes to bring them down to a more cleaned up and finished thickness. Currently, these things are at 1 3/4, and I think we'll probably end up somewhere around 1 3/8, 1 1/4 or so, judging by the amount of distortion and milling that still has to happen. That should still provide plenty of material to make for the substantial look that my sister is looking for. So those cleaned up really nicely. There's some really nice quarter sun ray fleck on this side over here. Got some curl coming in through here. And of course, some crotch figure there. So in preparation for getting these things joined back together with the epoxy, I do want to trim up the ends a little bit, clean things up a bit, and that'll make damming up that epoxy a little bit easier. So I'm gonna clamp these two things down to the bench and hang them over. That way I keep them aligned top to bottom, and to zip off a section with a track saw just to straighten things out, clean up the ends, and just make it a lot easier to contain that epoxy as it's getting towards the end of the board. So I'm gonna create a dam with some sheathing tape, and first I just wanna figure out which side I wanna fill this thing from. I'm guessing it's gonna be this side because this crack here in this bar conclusion probably doesn't go all the way through. So let's take a look at this side. Yes. So it's probably gonna be easiest for me to just get things going from this side. So this is going to be, I guess, this will be the fill side. then the other side will be the tape side. So with everything aligned up and down, left and right and everything, I'm gonna go ahead and basically just tape these two halves back together, making sure I create a really good seam as I come off the bottom face and up the end grain so that I don't have any leakage over there either. So now I just want to make sure that the seams are totally sealed together and the stuff is stuck down to the wood. What tends to be the biggest issue is leaking occurring between the layers where they're kind of suspended over air. So it's making sure that this is all nicely connected through here is going to help quite a bit. Another thing I'll do to make it a little bit easier on the tape is when I flip this thing over, I'll put it onto this board, which also has sheathing tape on it, and I'll clamp that down together so that will provide a really firm base for this thing to be down against, which just makes it harder for epoxy to escape. If it does escape, it's sitting on top of sheathing tape and it won't glue the two things together. I'm not super worried about this one because there isn't really a whole lot of volume that's gonna be in here. So now we need to know how much epoxy to actually mix up to fill this whole thing. And the best answer I have for that is I have no idea, but I can darn sure make a guess. So I'm gonna go with basically estimating a standard gap size all the way down the length. Through here, it's about 5/8. There's some bigger openings here. This is about 1/4 inch wide. So what I'm gonna do is just guess that we're gonna do a 3/4 inch wide gap down the entire length for the full thickness. So 3/4 inch times 27 inches times the thickness, which is 1 1/4 inches. So 27 times 0.75 times 1.25, that is 25 cubic inches. And if you multiply that by 0.55, that'll tell us the ounces, so about 14 ounces. Now what I'll do is when I get to the mixing cups, I will just mix a little more than that because it's probably gonna be easier to get to 16 ounces or something like that. And I'll have a little extra for filling in the other cracks and things in this piece of wood. I'll be using a slow set resin for this project. In my case, I happen to have Ecopoxy here in the shop, which is gonna allow me to do this pour all in one go. That's my preferred way of doing things versus using a traditional epoxy, which cures in under 24 hours, which you would have to do multiple pours with in order to fill up this void. I just personally prefer to just mix up one batch, pour it all at once, and then just leave it for, you know, 4-5 days and not have to worry about it. For the pigment, I'm gonna use some black powdered pigment. I wanna have some transparency to see down into those ant caverns and tracks, just to kind of show that off a little bit, but I don't want it to be super transparent either. So for the most part, Ecopoxy is going to be a pretty good self-degassing resin because it has such a long set time and it has such a low viscosity. There's plenty of time for bubbles to come up to the surface and either pop themselves or just remain on the surface to be removed later with a torch or be removed by surfacing your slab or whatever. But since I have the vacuum chamber, I just go ahead and help things along. I pull the bubbles to the surface and then I'll pop them with a torch. And usually after 2 or 3 of those iterations, there tends to be not very many bubbles remaining in the cup, and I can just go ahead and pour with fewer bubbles being introduced into the system. So I'm gonna go ahead and get started on pouring in here. One of the things you wanna keep in mind with pouring an epoxy like this is trapping bubbles. So your pouring strategy needs to be to pour in an area which is going to allow the epoxy to fill and flow out from the bottom of the cavity. So in my case, I have some areas in the middle as well as towards the kind of crotch area where I can see the tape beneath. Those are gonna be perfect areas for me to pour the epoxy. It's gonna flow all the way down to the bottom, hit the tape, and kind of flow out from there, fill in the entire crack from the bottom to the top. And that's gonna push any air out of the crack and not have any trapped air in there, or at least the lower possibility of trapped air being in there. And for anyone wondering, I mixed 18 ounces of resin just to make the math easier. Since this mixes at 2:1, that's gonna be 12 ounces of the resin and then 6 ounces of the hardener to make even 18 ounces. So this has been sitting here for 3 days now. It's not fully cured yet, but it's cured enough where I can remove it from the clamps and start working on some other stuff on it. I want to start filling some of the stuff on the other side and addressing all that. As you can see, I ended up using like all of the epoxy I mixed up. There's just a little bit down there in the bottom. So I think I did a pretty good job estimating how much stuff I was actually going to need. So I'm going to pull off these clamps and then we'll take a look at the bottom and see what kind of defects await us on the underside. Looks like I did have a little leak here coming from over here, maybe? I don't know. But luckily for me, I had it down on this other piece with the sheathing tape on it. So not a huge, huge deal. And actually, there's not really a whole lot of things on this side that need to be addressed. So I take that back. There is a little bit of kind of small fracture lines through here, which need to be filled. There's also this other hole right here, which didn't go all the way through to the other side, that needs to be filled as well. So at least those are small. I'm going to mix up some wet system, which is going to cure a lot faster, and just fill all these things up. And this thing should be ready to be kind of moving forward in the project by tomorrow. So that's looking like it is all ready to go from here. So it's time to do a little bit of cleanup work. So this does fit through my planer. It's only 18 inches wide up here. So I'm not really sure why I was using a router sled originally on this, but maybe this was so old. It's from when I had a 15 inch planer, not a 20 inch planer. I don't know. But anyway, it is still flat. So all I'm gonna do is use a sander to remove the excess epoxy on the bottom side, get it all cleaned up so there's no globs or anything that's gonna throw off the flatness registration. And then I can use the planer to clean up the other side, get rid of all that excess epoxy, and flush it all up. The epoxy does shrink a little bit as it's curing, so it is below the surface. So the planer will flush it up with the wood, and it'll all look perfect and good. And I can also trim up the ends to get those all cleaned up as well with the track saw again. So next I have some touch-up fills to do. You can see I had this bubble here, and there are some small cracks and some micro-fracturing over here, which need to be filled as well. A little bit of touch-up work, so I mixed up some of the faster-setting epoxy, and I'll just go over these areas and fill them up. And once that's cured, the epoxy work should be all done. So that takes care of the epoxy work. So next I'm going to figure out what I'm going to do with this live edge on here, since a good chunk of it over here is already missing. This is starting to pull away, and it's also starting to fall apart off the other side. I'm just going to remove all of it so it all matches. So let's just get a draw knife here and see what happens. So that edge was pretty easy. This side has this kind of limb area over here, and I have a little bit of epoxy that kind of leaked out from this crack into this area. So that might be a little more interesting, or I guess challenging, to make it look good. Or not so much good as uniform. So the only thing left to do now is to add some little hand holes down here so you can actually pick up this board. So I made a quick template out of some MDF, just cut this kind of notch out here at the table saw, and I'll use a router with a guide bushing. This is a half inch straight bit, and I'll follow along this pattern. I'll be able to route out a little pocket here so your hands can get in there. So that's about it. Now it's time for a little finish sanding. Get those surfaces all prepped and ready to go for finish. And also break the edges to make them all soft and smooth and feel real nice to the touch. All right, let me get my little goofy signature on here. All right, finish time. So for the finish on here, I'm going to use a salad bowl finish. I'll probably do 2 or 3 coats of that, depending on how it's going to look. And then I'll buff it out with a coat of wax, which should help to smooth everything out, get rid of any bumps or nibs or anything that's on the surface, and just even out the sheen as well. So I'm especially excited about finishing this side because the finish is going to bring back the clarity in the epoxy and allow us to see down in there. We'll be able to kind of see how everything looks, see how the color looks, see how the transparency looks and all that. Also kind of excited because all through here is a bunch of Rayfleck. So this is all quarter sun maple right there. So for all of you Rayfleck lovers, you got that going on there as well. Oh yeah, that's just about what I had in mind. It's not super clear, so we can actually see down there a little bit, but I can't see all the way through it, which is right where I wanted the pigmentation to be. So you can tell there is some cavities and caverns and stuff down here, but you can't see all the way down to my bench beneath it. It looks like it's a really deep void, or at least a lot deeper than it really is. Looks like it might be like 3 inches deep, but it's only about an inch and change. And yeah, we got some crotch figure over here. You know, no big deal. I did 3 coats of finish. The heartwood was still kind of absorbing finish as I was going. So that's why I put a 3rd coat on. Otherwise, 2 would have been okay. So now I'm just going to apply a little bit of wax to the surface and just buff it out. That's really just going to make the finish look a little bit nicer because there's a pretty good amount of dust nibs in here. I wasn't too careful about all of that. And if there are any uneven spots in the finish, that should help to even things out as well. So just like that, one quick serving board and just in time too because we're heading out today and I'll be giving this to my sister and her husband today. This should serve a few things. So these are the kind of projects that I really enjoy from time to time. It's nice to do submess relatively quick and something that maybe you've done already before. You can just kind of mindlessly go through the motions and get out in the shop and get something made. Not everything has to be this crazy prototyping experience to make this new thing you've never made before. Sometimes it's just nice to be able to make something you have made before, something you understand how to make real easily, and just have fun in the shop and not have to worry about the project you're making and not working out because you don't know what you're doing. So I'm really happy with the way this thing turned out. I think it looks pretty darn amazing. There's some really nice figure in this piece of wood. There's some nice quarter sawn areas over here. So you have some really nice ray fleck over there. You have some curl throughout the piece. You have some crotch figure. And I think the epoxy job with the ant tracks in there, I think I got that right where I wanted to be. It's not super clear, but you can also see down in there and you can see that there are some old ant tracks and pathways in there. So I think, I think it's gonna work out pretty nicely. I am very happy with this. I feel like she'll like this, but what do I know? So that's gonna do it for this one. Thank you as always for watching. I greatly appreciate it. If you have any questions or comments on this serving tray thing or anything here in the shop, please feel free to leave me a comment. As always, I'd be happy to answer any questions you might have. And until next time, happy woodworking.